Gretchen, thank you so much for being here, for taking my email and agreeing to come on the show. It's just a huge honor. Thank you so much.
I'm so happy to have the chance to talk to you. Thanks so much for thinking of me.
Yeah, well, I feel like I have already done your introduction. I feel like you need no introduction, but, you know, one more time, just for everybody who's getting settled in here, five-time New York Times bestseller, podcast host of Happier with Gretchen Rubin, over 100 million downloads, speaker, and what my subject line to you said in the email, fellow Yale Law grad turned author. So I was 06 and immediately after graduating, started a photography business with my husband for 15 years. And then as soon as I got comfortable with that, decided to pivot into author. And so a couple of other quick things we have kind of in common, at least on the fringes, is you clerked for Sandra Day O'Connor. She was actually our guest speaker at our graduation.
How fun. That's great. Oh, yeah.
She was amazing. And the other big one that's not at all the same, but we'll say it anyway, is you were the editor-in-chief of Yale Law's Review, the Yale Law Journal. I was the director of the Yale Law Review, R-E-V-U-E.
Oh, much more fun. Yes.
And actually, I was wondering if you had that as well. So I will show you this picture very quickly from my book, Dirt. I dressed up as a 6-foot lobster, drove from New Haven to Cambridge and attempted to get admitted to Harvard Law as a lobster as part of one of our skits. So let me see if I can find that to show you because it is quite epic. Let's see if you can see that.
That's quite more elaborate than
I don't know if you can see that. Well,
look at that. Where did you get that costume? Holy smokes.
There was
that's
just
a real thing.
Really sketchy place in New Haven.
Oh, fun.
Yeah. Well, so now that we know that, you know, those are not at all the same, the Yale Law Review and the Yale Law Review,
I spent a lot of time looking at whether a period was italicized or not. That was something we had to be very careful about.
Yeah.
Real attention to detail.
That's right. I think for our episode, what I would love to do is I want to camp for a little while in the four tendencies.
Wonderful.
I just feel like, well, first of all, I will tell you that I took the quiz in the book. Is the quiz in the book and the quiz online, are they the same?
I think it's, you know, I'm constantly, you know what the lawyers are like, I'm tinkering with stuff all the time, so they might be slightly different, but essentially they're the same questions,
So I came very close between two, so maybe you will help me through the course of this episode figure out. So I was almost tied between questioner and obliger, which is interesting because you are, well, we'll get into it. Let's talk about it. The four tendencies are, this is one of your many best-selling books. It's the indispensable personality profiles that reveal how to make your life better and other people's lives better, too. And the whole book is based on the premise that by asking one suspiciously simple question, how do I respond to expectations, we can gain explosive self-knowledge from both those outer and inner expectations. So just walk us through, what are the four tendencies?
Yes. Well, and if for people who want to take the quiz right now, you could just go to quiz.gretchenrubin.com.
Nice.
And the advantage of taking the quiz online is that you get an answer. Like, it weighs those things for you. So you're kind of like, feel caught between two. Well, if you take it online.
Okay.
Like 3 million people have taken that quiz. It's quick. It's free. So, but I can explain it very quickly. And these are very obvious. Once you know what to look for, you see them in the people around you, you see them in yourself. I could do the Game of Thrones characters. I can do Mad Men characters. I could do movies. Like, these are very blatant. Mm. So as you said, it sounds very boring, but it ends up being really juicy, how you respond to expectations. Mm. So all of us face two kinds of expectations. Outer expectations, like a work deadline. Mm. Inner expectations, like my own desire to keep a New Year's resolution. So whether you meet an expectation or resist an expectation in combination, that's what makes you an upholder, a questioner, an obliger, or a rebel. So we think that you're maybe a questioner, maybe an obliger. We'll figure that out.
One of those two. Well, so what's interesting is that there are a few like unshakable rules that you have about the tendencies. You say, number one, you are hardwired with these tendencies. They are not the result of birth order, parenting style, religious upbringing, gender, introversion versus extroversion. Yeah. How do you know that? Is that in the research that you did, or just like as you were developing it's something you feel about them? How do you know that?
Well, I'm a big believer in the genetic roots of personality generally. And definitely, if you know the four tendencies, you see them in children from a very young age. I don't think it's the kind of thing that's susceptible to, I mean, I think with age and experience and certainly culture will shape how your tendency comes out. But I think it's part of kind of what you bring into the world with you. But maybe I should just sort of quickly lay out what the four are so people can be kind of projecting themselves into our conversation, have a sense of what they are.
Yes.
So upholders readily meet outer and inner expectations. So they meet the work deadline. They keep the New Year's resolution without much fuss. They want to know what other people expect from them, but their expectations for themselves are just as important. So they tend to love to-do lists, calendars, schedules. Yeah. They tend not to like spontaneity. They're very focused on execution. They can sometimes seem rigid because they want to stick to their plans. So their motto is discipline is my freedom.
Yeah.
Then there are questioners, maybe you. Questioners question all expectations. They'll do something if they think it makes sense. They resist anything arbitrary, inefficient, unjustified. They tend to love to customize. They tend to love research. They don't like something like a New Year's resolution because they say, well, January 1st is an arbitrary date. Why would I do it on January 1st? So they're making everything an inner expectation. If it meets their inner standard, they'll do it no problem. If it fails their inner standard, they will push back. So their motto is, I'll comply if you convince me why.
Yeah.
Then there are obligers. Obligers readily meet outer expectations, but they struggle to meet inner expectations. And I got my insight into this tendency when a friend said to me, you know, it's weird. I know I'm happier when I exercise. And when I was in high school, I was on the track team and I never missed track practice.
Right.
So why can't I go running now? Well, when she had a team and a coach expecting her to show up, no problem. But when she's just trying to go on her own, it's a challenge. So the key for obligers is if there's an inner expectation, you have to create a system of outer accountability. You want to read more, join a book group. You want to exercise more. Work out with a trainer, work out with a friend who'll be annoyed if you don't show up. Take your dog for a run who's going to be so disappointed if you don't do it. Raise money for a charity. Think of your duty to your future self. Mm-hmm. It's not self-care. It's not priorities. It's not putting yourself first. It's outer accountability. Mm-hmm. But they come through amazingly for others. And that is why their motto is, you can count on me and I'm counting on you to count on me.
That's right.
And then the final tendency is rebel. So rebels resist all expectations, outer and inner alike. They want to do what they want to do, what they choose to do in their own way and in their own time. So they can do anything they want to do. But if you ask or tell them to do something, they're very likely to resist. And typically they don't tell themselves what to do. Like they don't sign up for a 10 a.m. woodworking class on Saturday because they think, oh, I don't know what I'm going to want to do on Saturday. And just the idea that someone's expecting me to show up is going to annoy me.
Right.
So their motto is, you can't make me and neither can I. So those are the four.
Amazing. Amazing. So another very important criteria that you have for the tendencies is that you squarely fall into one. It's not so much like the Enneagram maybe where you have a wing of something or you...
Oh, no, you do have a wing.
That's true.
You squarely fit into one, but you sort of tip in one direction or another.
Right.
So it can be colored. Like you can be a questioner who tips to upholder and that will be different from a questioner who tips to rebel. But I think you're right that you do fit within one tendency. It just kind of takes a shade of color from a different from whatever is the overlapping tendency.
So I was thinking about this, and like ironically, the fact that I'm going to ask you this question probably points me more towards the questioner side. But the thing that I was wondering is like when I was thinking about like, gosh, it's so weird that the things that I feel like I fall into one or the other, they're the opposites. They're not even like.
Yes.
The wings of one.
No,
the thing that went through my head is I feel like I am an obliger when I'm wearing a mask and I'm still in the people pleasing version of myself and I don't want to disappoint people, but at my like truest self, I was asking why even before Simon Sinek released that book. Do you know what I mean? Like I want to know why. I want to know what, you know, the arbitrary
so
is very important
to
me.
Here's the essential question is what gets you to do something? It's not how you feel on the inside. It's what gets you to, because if you just made up your mind, if you're like, you know what, I'm going to quit sugar. I read a book, like I read Gary Tobbs's Why We Get Fit. I'm just going to quit sugar. Could you just up and do that? And like, okay, fine. Or would you find that to be really challenging to have an inner expectation like that? And one that might inconvenience other people or kind of make them you know, maybe disapprove or whatever? Or would you feel like I would do much better if, like, a friend and I said, we're going to do this together, and every day we texted back and forth, or I thought about how I wanted to make a change that would benefit the people in my household, because if I'm eating healthier, they're eating healthier, or I'm going to sign up with a coach who's going to, like, hold me to it. So it's not sort of what you think. It's what makes you act a certain way.
Yeah.
So do you think if you just made up your mind that something was important, your actions would flow pretty easily? Or do you think you need those outer structures of accountability?
Now, is an outer structure of accountability a deadline, like negative consequences to me if I don't hit it?
Yeah. A deadline is a classic form of accountability.
So that's an obliger. If I'm like, I don't want the negative consequences to me, like getting a bad grade on the paper, would that put me in the obliger territory?
Well, that's just a good sense. I think even rebels who are free of outer and inner, the one thing they do respond to is consequences. So it's more like if I said to you, if I said to you, listen, we have this report, I really need it by Friday. And you're like, okay, I know for a fact that Gretchen's not going to look at that until the Wednesday following. Would you be like, I'm not going to give it to you on Friday, because why would I? That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
You're in obliger, you're like, well, she said she needed it, so I think I feel a lot of pressure to meet that deadline.
I would want to know why. If you're not going to open it till Wednesday, I'd be like, do you really need it by Friday, or can we push it? So that's maybe more questioner.
Right.
Interesting.
But it's also interesting that thinking that you're a little bit of other tendencies tends to be a questioner thing, because questioners are like, well, in a certain circumstance, would it make sense, I would act like that.
Right.
And so that's also a sign.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's talk about upholders first, because that's what you are.
Yes.
And you talk about, as you've already said, meets both inner and outer expectations. And you said that one of the biggest questions you got when you wrote The Happiness Project and Happier at Home was from people going, yeah, but when you were trying out those habits to see how much happier they made you, like, but how did you stick with the habit?
Yes.
And you were like, what are you talking about? I just did them.
I was totally mystified.
Yeah. So it was like the other three tendencies coming to an upholder and going, but like, I couldn't even get to that place. Because how did you stick with the habit?
Yes. Well, and first I thought, okay, this is a habit formation question. So then I wrote a whole book Better Than Before about habit. Yeah. But that just then gave you to the question, but how do people change their habits? Like, why sometimes can they change their habits and sometimes they can't? Well, there's many, many factors. But one of the major factors that I turned up was the four tendencies.
Yeah.
So it was really like my own puzzlement in the face of other people's puzzlement that showed me that in some way I was seeing the world very differently from the way they were seeing it.
Yeah. And you said that the four tendencies actually began, it's chapter one of Better Than Before.
Yeah.
And so it grew out of that and then became a whole book.
Because I would give like book talks or whatever, and I would talk about all the juiciest, most, you know, exciting ideas I thought from Better Than Before, which I think is a book that's full of like fascinating, because habits are so fascinating.
Yeah.
And all anybody wanted to talk about was the four tendencies.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, I think I need to write a whole book about just the four tendencies. I didn't realize when I stumbled across it in my studies of human nature, I didn't realize like how big it was going to get for me.
Yeah. You say, as you mentioned, that discipline brings freedom. They are good at time off, taking care of self, because they get stuff done with very little drama, and it leaves time for all of this time off. And I was just reading that
But it's not even that it frees up time. It's that they hold on to that time. So I would very easily say, hey, Mary, I know you'd like me to work late, but I have a 6 o'clock yoga class, so I have to leave work.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so they're good. And that can make them seem cold at times, because sometimes they're like, well, something's really important to you, but something else is important to me. So I can't help you.
Yeah.
This makes them seem cold.
This was your friend who said, everybody out of the dinner party, I've got to get to bed. I've got to get ready.
Yeah, I'm like, I get it, of course.
But the line in particular there that you mentioned of getting stuff done with very little drama, I just like put the book down. I was like, what's that like, Gretchen? What is that like? Like, that was just like not me at all in law school. Everything was dramatic. Writing books, everything is dramatic. Like down to the last minute before midnight, sending it off to hit the deadline. Like the idea that like just things can get done. And it's not dramatic. Like, I was just like, well, tell us what that's like. The other three groups, tell us what that's like.
Well, you know, I do have to, I think everybody often, not always, but often people have a soft spot for their own tendency. And I definitely have a soft spot for my own tendency. And the one thing I would say that is great about being an upholder is that the person that I can count on the most in this world is myself. Yeah. I know that I can count on myself. And I didn't realize that that is not that common, mm-hmm. that people have that feeling. And so I do feel like if I say I'm going to write a paper, I know that I can get that done. Mm-hmm. And that's great.
Yeah. And does that ever tip into the only person I can count on is myself? Like, does it ever go into that territory?
Well, that's a very astute question, because mm-hmm. the thing that upholders often talk about is our problem with delegation. Mm-hmm. We often feel like we're the only ones who can do it right. We're the only ones who can be trusted. And so it can be very hard to delegate. So that is something but of course, if you can't delegate, then that's a huge limitation on what you can do. And so that is something that upholders have to work on. Absolutely.
As an upholder who is good at meeting both inner and outer expectations, how do you decide which one of those will trump if they're intention? Is it always inner? Does it depend?
Back to this idea of the tipping, right? Mm. The tipping.
Yeah.
So I'm an upholder who tips to questioner, and questioners and upholders share that they meet inner expectations.
Okay.
And so I would say on balance, I would prefer the inner expectation. Mm. I definitely have an air of coldness. I mean, I feel that in my nature.
I don't feel that.
Well, that's nice to hear. But mm-hmm. I do feel like sometimes I'm kind of like, yeah, like that would be nice. But I just like that's not a priority for me or whatever. Mm. But then there are upholders who tip to obligers, and obligers and upholders both readily meet outer expectations. And then you see upholders who really feel a lot more anguish when outer and inner expectations are in conflict. Mm. So like I know a writer who is an upholder who tips to obliger. And so if she works at home where like her family's all around, she finds the tension between outer and inner very unbearable. And so she will like leave. She'll make herself extremely unavailable unless like it's a true emergency because she has no trouble following inner expectations, but she's very distracted if outer expectations are being expected of her. So she puts herself in a situation where she doesn't feel that conflict.
Mm. And have you felt any of that during pandemic and quarantine where work and home are suddenly at home?
Well, you know, I have big kids who are very like self-motivated. Mm. And so I don't have like, you know, a 3-year-old who needs a lot of supervision or a third grader who needs help getting onto Zoom. And
right.
So it hasn't been a particular issue for me. Thankfully, I feel really grateful that I haven't really had that conflict so much.
Mm. You know, one of the things I was thinking about and something I understand very intimately is, you know, here's Gretchen, Yale Law grad, editor-in-chief of the journal, female editor-in-chief of the journal, Supreme Court clerk, clerking actually at that clerkship with Sandra Day O'Connor, and you decide you want to pivot and write books. And I had a very similar thing where it's like, grew up in a trailer in West Virginia, make it all the way to Yale Law School. I'm just finally about to graduate and decide to start a wedding photography business. And there was definitely, you know, some moms of friends back home that were like, one mom in particular said to me, all that schooling, you know, who just sort of thought like my outer expectations, my parents' expectations, my hometown's expectations of like girl who had done well or what have you versus my inner expectations of I know this is where I'm being called. So did you feel that tension when of like family or people who had watched you reach, you know, the A++ of the A+ school that didn't understand that pivot?
Well, you know, I was really fortunate because the people in my life were very accepting of taking a big risk. Mm. And I think that's very unusual. And now that I'm a parent myself, I realize like how unusual it is, because as a parent, like from the deepest love, you want your children to be safe. You don't want them to risk failure. You don't want them to risk getting their, you know, their feelings hurt. You don't want them to face uncertainty. Mm. And certainly you and I on graduating were kind of set up to have like a very kind of clear, secure path to, you know, kind of a comfortable life. And so I was fortunate that the people in my life were kind of like, okay, yeah, whatever, this is happening. Let's do it. You know, and for Justice O'Connor, I'm not even the strangest pivot that she has. There was somebody who I overlap with briefly who became a tenor in the Boston Opera.
Oh, yeah.
And now he's back to practicing. But I was like, that's even more far afield than being a writer, is singing in the opera.
Yeah.
But it is, I think it can make a change very painful for people if everybody around them is questioning their judgment.
Mm. What is upholder tightening?
This is when the rules get tighter and tighter for you as an upholder. So like, you know, you start off, like I remember talking to a medical student who said she started off not reading her notes before class. And then a few times she read notes before class for a few classes. Then she started reviewing all her notes before all her classes, even though she knew that it wasn't really the best use of her time. I'm like, you're experiencing tightening and you need to mindfully tap into your inner expectation of using your time well, because you're becoming a bureaucrat of your own red tape. You know, you got to pull yourself out of that.
And what is a good way of doing that? Like you said, mindfulness, but like when somebody, if somebody's listening and they're like, oh, I'm in that right now. Like my response to outward stress in the world has been to tighten the rules on the inside.
Well, that's a very astute comment. And I will say this for upholders, that other people often say, like, under a lot of stress, lighten your load, ease up. That tends not to be comforting for upholders. Yeah. Upholders feel more comforted by going deeper into their rules and into their plans and execution. And so they find that comforting. So I would say as an upholder, if you find that comforting, like use that. I mean, I often will comfort myself in that way. Mm. But if it has tipped over into really being choking, when it's getting in the way of like deeper values, it's really about articulating it for yourself. If the inner expectation is clearly articulated, it will balance out the outer expectation or whatever the conflicting inner expectation is. So you really just have to like state it for yourself very clearly, not let yourself fall and drift into default patterns.
Mm, love that. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the questioners.
Yes. This is the second biggest group, by the way. Obliger is the biggest group for both men and women, and questioner is the second biggest group.
Okay. They are going to resist outer expectations, meet inner expectations, unless and until somebody's outer expectation makes enough sense to them, they understand the why, that it becomes an inner expectation.
Exactly.
Statements like, we've always done it this way, this is standard practice, I'm the boss, carry absolutely no weight. Yeah. They want to know, why should I listen to you? Why are you qualified to tell me what to do? Yeah. And they have, I liked this sentence a lot. This spoke to me. They have the self-direction of upholders, the reliability of obligers, and the authenticity of rebels. So I liked that. I liked those qualities from each one. That kind of made me go, oh, that feels right. But questioners, for them, because they, you know, where upholders tighten in their rules or they tighten in their expectations, questioners can really get stuck spinning out in their research, and that turns into an analysis paralysis where they know all the options and too much choice becomes no choice at all.
Right. Yes. And not all questioners experience this. Some have kind of figured out how to get them stop spinning out of control. But a questioner friend of mine called it like the black hole of research, where it's just like so attractive to you, you can't help but be sucked in.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they need to use things like deadlines and limitations and trusted authorities as ways to get themselves out of analysis process. Or sometimes just thinking, you know, because they put such a high value on efficiency, saying, you know, it's not efficient to keep researching. Like at a certain point, it makes sense for me to just like use my best judgment, make the best decision that I can, and then learn from whatever I learn.
Mm.
Because it can be really, they can become real bottlenecks for themselves and for others if they can't move forward.
What have we seen questioners do to respond to quarantine, pandemic, times of uncertainty? What do they, is it just like research them? Like, is that like doom scrolling, like going down the rabbit hole of
getting
scary
very
research?
Well, it's interesting because sometimes questioner, it can lead you to make your own conclusions, even when those are very, very much out of step with what expert advice is, because questioners are like, well, I looked at the research and sure, I haven't been to, you know, I don't have a medical degree, but I could tell you what I think.
Yeah.
So they can sometimes like trust their own judgment and their own analysis, even when others, I mean, I have a friend who's a questioner who basically like interfered with his own cancer treatment because he was like, well, I've read the same studies everybody else has read. And they're like, well, but like, you know, like, you know, but you don't know as much as they do, but he felt very confident in his own judgment. So that's one thing that you can sometimes see with questioners. And I think questioners also, they don't like anything arbitrary. So like everybody has to do this. It's like, well, does everybody have to do it? Because like even things like speed limits can sometimes, or like five garments to a dressing room can annoy, because they're like, well, I don't understand why five, or I'm a great driver, so I don't understand why I'm driving the same speed as somebody who's a terrible driver. Or I don't understand why, research shows that if you're in the park, it's, so they really want to get into it and they don't like it when it's sort of like, well, everybody's just expected to do this. And so that's very painful to them.
Yeah.
To feel like they're being subjected to rules that don't make sense or rules that are arbitrary.
You know, I was thinking, you mentioned in particular in the book, Steve Jobs as a questioner, and you talk about like when he became sick, how that was, a challenge. But I'm also thinking of the famous Apple commercial in light of him being a questioner, where it's like, here's to the crazy ones. They're not fond of rules. They're not much for the status quo. They're the round pegs in the square hole. Yeah. And it's kind of like, he's like, that's the anthem for questioners.
It's interesting because I really debated whether he's a questioner or a rebel, because I would say that advertising campaign kind of tips to rebel.
Okay.
I think people like to think of themselves as rebels. There's a lot of things that are tough about being a rebel. And I really debated, was Steve Jobs a rebel who tipped a questioner, or was he a questioner who tipped a rebel? And in the end, I decided he worked, at these public companies. He was part of enormous machines of creation and fulfillment. And I just thought, I just don't think he would have been able to do it the way he did it as a rebel. Mm. So I think he's a questioner who tipped a rebel, but he definitely had a lot of that rebel spirit to him. And I think that exactly those slogans that you point to are kind of an expression of that.
Of the rebel side, more the rebel side.
Kind of that rebel spirit, yeah. Mm,
love that. And then last thing on questioners that I thought was very interesting and I can relate to as well is that questioners, ironically, don't like being asked questions themselves.
Yes, now some questioners have this, some don't. I'm married to a questioner who so embodies this. He will not answer the simplest question. I mean, what are we having for dinner? Food. When are we leaving for the airport? Later. I have to say why. I have to say, what time are we leaving for the airport? Because I'm wondering if I have time to go to the gym.
Yeah.
Like, I have to explain why, or he just simply will not answer a question.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense to me, though, in the way you describe it in the book. It's like, we have already put so much time into analyzing and deciding what would be the right course of action. Like, why do I need to explain it? Just trust me.
I don't even want to get into it. Yeah, I know. It's ironic. Believe me. People are like, but this is very ironic. I'm like, believe me, I live that irony every day. But one thing is, when you know what it's coming from, it's a lot easier to ask a question in a way that makes them understand why you're asking. And then you get more cooperation.
Yeah, that's right. That's an important thing to talk about in the book, is that each of the tendencies are divided into understanding that tendency and then actually working with that tendency. There's understanding and dealing with each personality, each tendency.
Because you can imagine, you're with a coworker and you keep asking questions about what is this and what did you get for that? And, how did we do last week? And the person just isn't answering the question. Mm-hmm. Well, they might be thinking if they care, they can look it up. Or I don't understand why they need to know that. That's really not part of their business. I'm not here to do your homework for you.
Right.
But if you said something I'm not able to get into that dashboard because I don't have clearance, but if you could quickly take a look, that would help me link your department and my department so that I can show. So it's like, okay, you're like, okay, well, why do I have to go through that extra step? Why can't I just ask? Because the fact is, they probably won't answer you. Or if they're not answering you, it's because they just don't see that there's a point to it. So at least, even if you feel like it's kind of annoying, at least you know what to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about obligers, the largest group. They meet outer expectations, not resist inner expectations. You can count on me and I need you. I'm counting on you to count on me to get it done. And you talk about things like cleaning the house because people are coming over, which I super resonated with, that they dislike living with routines, a set calendar and structure. And you said that obligers and rebels, which we're going to get into, are the two tendencies that are hardest to deal with. What is that about the routine, set calendar and structure that obligers don't like?
No, I mean, they're harder for other people to deal with, because I think sometimes questioners and upholders will say things like, well, I don't want to be your babysitter. Do your work in your own way. Get it back to me when you're ready. I'm going to work how I'm going to send you. I had this conflict with a coworker who was an obliger. Mm. I was like, I want to send emails morning, noon and night, on vacation, on holidays, on weekends. Answer me when you want. It's you work when you want to work. That's not my business.
Right.
But she felt like I was violating kind of the boundary between work and home. She felt like I wasn't respecting her, that I was taking advantage of her responsiveness. And it's sort of like, but to me, I'm like, that's not my problem to manage. That's your, you manage you. But the reality is I was creating expectations for her that were hard for her to manage. So what I did, like, by the way, is used how to use delay delivery in Outlook. So she just would get emails from me, like, you know, on Monday morning or whatever.
Right.
So that I could work my way and she could work her way. But it can be hard when people are like, well, I don't want to have to set a boundary for you. I want you to deal with your own boundaries. Or I don't want to have to set a deadline for you. And creating accountability is often very burdensome. And sometimes obligers will ask others for accountability. And people are like, well, I don't want to do it because it's too much work. And so then you have to find somebody who wants to, whether because they gain from it or maybe they're like a professional, like a coach or a trainer or something like that. And so that's one of the reasons, I think, that you kind of have to think about whether you're being unreasonable, which I'm kind of like, I want to just go ahead and be unreasonable.
Yeah. You know, I'm thinking like there's that sentence, and I think it's even one of the ones you list for upholders, that your lack of preparation is not my emergency.
Yes.
And the line was kind of coming to my mind of like an upholder or everybody else to an obliger, like your lack of boundaries is not my problem. Like you feeling like you have to respond morning, noon, and night is not my problem.
But here's the thing, it 100% is our problem. And that's obliger rebellion. Mm. Obliger rebellion is this very mysterious, it seems mysterious in life, but then once you know what it is, it's very obvious what's going on. It's very common.
Yeah.
Obliger rebellion is when obligers feel like neglected or taken advantage of or unheard or ignored, and they meet expectations, but then suddenly they snap.
Yeah.
And they say, this I will not do. Their resentment and their anger has been brewing and building. And suddenly they're like, I'm not going to answer your emails for 2 weeks, or I'm going to quit this job, or I'm going to divorce you, or I'm going to end our 20-year friendship because it's too much.
Yeah.
You're dead to me. It's over. And this is something that's very puzzling to the other tendencies. It's often puzzling to the obligers themselves because they're like, I don't understand where this is coming from. I'm acting out of character. They often say, but when you understand the building resentment, you can see it coming from very far off.
Yeah, that part was really interesting to me because it kind of reminded me of, you know, in the Myers-Briggs world, the INFJ has this thing called the INFJ door slam, where it's like,
ooh, I don't know about that.
Yeah, you should check it out. You would love it. So
I'm going to write that down.
Yeah,
INFJ. I like that door slam. That's like drop mic. It's
that's
like,
right.
You get it.
That's right. We're out. It's like, I will assume the best in you. I will forgive you. I will love you. I will look for your wounds. I will try to like see you until the moment I realize it's never going to get healed. You're never going to be better. And then it's like, boom, switch flips. You're dead to me. Done. Yeah. It's very,
I wonder if they're similar. Looking at the same behavior and interpreting it in a different way. Because I would say it's that when someone feels like outer expectations have become so overwhelming that it just like that you have to pull the escape,
hatch, claws, all the things.
I lost parachutes. My metaphor there. Push the escape button.
Yeah.
Drop, you know, jump out with your parachute because you can't take it anymore.
Yeah.
And you see this when, and like to your point about like your boundaries, it's like, if I'm like, hey, Mary, would you be on this committee? Would you be on this committee? Would you be on this committee? And you're like, well, I'm on 11 committees and other people are like 2-3 committees. Mm. But I'm like, it's your job to tell me that you don't want to do it. And then you quit and go work for a competitor, and I've lost my best employee. That's my problem.
Right.
You know, I need to manage that. It's the right thing to do to make things fair. It's not right to take advantage of people.
Yeah.
But it's also, they're often extremely valuable. So you don't want to risk that.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that. You say, because they think they shouldn't have to protest. They imagine that others must realize the oppressiveness of the burdens being imposed and will or should lift those burdens without any word from them. That is, the obliger expects others to know to stop imposing.
But see, this was the thing that was the huge light bulb for me. It's like, you don't realize how deeply rooted you are in your own perspective. You don't understand that other people truly see a different world. And it was such a revelation for me to see how obligers were like, how are you not feeling this? How do you not get this? And I'm like, I literally feel none of this. This is like not a feather on my face. I don't understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But they're absolutely baffled. Well, one hilarious place you can see this, if you're back in, if we're all back to normal, go look at the signs in an office kitchen. And you will see all four tendencies like battling it out, because they all have a very different view about what the right way to behave in an office kitchen is.
So I'm thinking of like the episode of The Office where Pam is tired of the microwave and leaves the sign. Yes. Obliger Rebellion?
Yes. Yes.
Nice. Yes. Nice. All right. Yeah. All right.
She is an obliger, and she does. There's a couple of, you know, your office. Yeah. There's a couple times where she experiences Obliger Rebellion. Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. Let's talk about rebels, our last of the four tendencies. Resist both inner and outer expectations. I don't want you to make me, and I don't want to make me either. You said one of my favorite, this made me actually laugh out loud, that you heard from a rebel person or friend in the book. You said, the rebel said, I recently got an email that the subject line said, please read, and I deleted it immediately. And I was like, oh my gosh, that like makes me sweat to even think about. Interesting. So they, what I thought was really fascinating, and I think about this all the time, in like the Enneagram, there's the challenger personality who like anything everybody likes, they want to challenge it. And I think to them like, but you're still being affected by the whims of trends, just 100%. The other way. So you talk about that. You say rebels don't see that they are responding to peer pressure just the other way. Talk a little bit about like getting a rebel to understand that.
Yeah. I mean, resistance is not compliance, but resistance is not freedom. Because, and it's interesting because some rebels tip to questioner and they're very much like, I've got to march to the beat of my own drum. I'm going to do me, you do you. They don't have so much the spirit of resistance. Whereas rebels who tip to obliger are much more kind of reactive. Mm. And if you tell me to do something, well, then I won't do it, even if I want to do it. And this is something that's really important to understand the people around you, especially if you're dealing with children, or coworker, anybody, spouses. If you're dealing with that kind of rebel, if you tell them to do something, even if they were planning to do it or they were already doing it, you might cause them to stop because they do not want anyone to think that they're being controlled.
Yeah.
And this can come up in weird ways. Like, hey, Mary, I'm so glad to hear that you're finally following the doctor's orders and taking your blood pressure medication. That is so fantastic. What? You think I'm doing what the doctor told me to? You think I'm following doctor's orders?
Yeah.
No. Is that okay? Or like I've heard this specific anecdote from several teenager rebels where they're like, I like making my bed because I like my room to be a certain way. But if one of my parents says to me, don't forget to make your bed, I just like throw the covers onto the floor.
Wow.
So you want to know if the person that you're engaging with is like that, or if it's like that yourself, if you're like that yourself, because you don't want to get into a situation where you feel like you can't do the things that you want to do and that would benefit you because other people are getting in your way.
Yeah. You have a line where you say a rebel on a mission is a force of nature, a superstar. So what, talk a little bit about that impact of mission in particular.
Well, one of the things that's interesting about rebels, and this is true of all the tendencies, is it's very informed by your values. It's not like some people are like, all rebels are visionaries, or all rebels are narcissists, or all rebels act like teenagers. It's like, no, they don't. It completely depends on what their values are and what they want.
Yeah.
And so if you have a rebel who has a mission, who's very driven towards some goal, like their sense of authenticity, their sense of like clarity, they're just like, you know, just their desire to put themselves and their values out into the world just makes them incredibly effective and kind of unstoppable. But that doesn't mean that all rebels are like that, because some rebels don't really care about other people.
Yeah.
And you notice those folks too, because if there's somebody who really just doesn't care about other people and they're not going to do what you ask them or tell them to do, unless like they're actually going to get in trouble for it, like that's kind of hard to work with. But but many rebels are highly motivated by consideration, reliability, justice, very, very high values.
Yeah. Yeah. Love it. So last big question here is, in Better Than Before, you mentioned, you go into how to set some habits that really start to change your life, how to sleep more, quit sugar, procrastinate less, a generally happier life. Just kind of like the brief overview for people who are listening and they already have an idea in their head of which of the tendencies they are. What have you learned about each tendency when it comes to setting good habits?
So in Better Than Before, I identified the 21 strategies that you can use to make or break your habits. And it's good that there's so many. It seems kind of overwhelming, but then you can pick and choose the ones that are most useful to you.
Yeah.
And some are useful for just about anyone, like the strategies of convenience and inconvenience. We're all affected by convenience and inconvenience. But some strategies, as you say, are particularly useful for different tendencies. Mm-hmm. So if you're an upholder, the strategy of scheduling and the strategy of monitoring tend to be particularly effective.
Yeah.
meaning like you put it on the schedule, it gets done. You see how much you do of something, and that helps keep you on track.
Yeah.
Similarly, questioners, they tend to love to monitor. These are kind of the self-hacking people. They love information and data, especially about themselves. So they do very well with monitoring. They also do very well with clarity, because they have to know, why am I doing this? Why am I eating this way? Why am I exercising this way instead of that way or that way or that way? So for them, the strategy of clarity is very important. We've talked about it before. For obligers, the crucial strategy is the strategy of accountability. That is the essential strategy for obligers. They can, you know, and then all the others can help them make the most of accountability, but they really have to build in that outer accountability. And then for rebels, because identity is so important for rebels, the strategy of identity is key for them, because it's like, I'm doing this because this is the kind of person I am. Yeah. I practice the piano because I'm a musician. I go running every day because I'm an athlete. I pick up my kids every day at the same time, even though I hate doing drudge work at the same time every day, because I'm a reliable, responsible parent who wants to make my children feel like they can rely on me. That's the kind of person I am. That's my identity. And that's how my habits flow from that.
Mm, Gretchen, well, this has been incredible. Let everybody know where they can get this book, where they can get more of you, where they can take the quiz, where they can listen to the podcast, all those
things. So much, more than anybody would ever want. So my site, GretchenRubin.com, is kind of the clearinghouse, so you can look up any of my books. There's all kinds of free resources. You can take the quiz there, or you could just go straight to the quiz, which is quiz.GretchenRubin.com. Again, it's free and quick. My podcast is Happier with Gretchen Rubin, where I talk about happiness each week with my sister, Elizabeth Kraft. And then on social media, I'm all over the place. Just my handle is Gretchen Rubin everywhere. And I love hearing from people. I love insights and observations and questions. It's really, like you mentioned in the Four Tendencies, it's filled with examples that people sent to me, because they're like, oh, let me tell you about what happened to me. Like, just amazing. The world is my research assistant. So I love to connect with people.
Love that. All right, friends, the book is The Four Tendencies, The Indispensable Personality Profiles That Reveal How to Make Your Life Better and Other People's Lives Better Too. Take the quiz, find out which tendency you are, and get this book into your hands. Now make sure you keep the conversation going with Gretchen as you head over to our new YouTube channel for The Mary Moran Show. It's linked in the show notes, or you can head to marymoran.com/YouTube. Over there, you are going to get even more bonus content not featured in this episode, where I'm going to be specifically, really quickly asking Gretchen what it's like writing a book about how to be happier at home and then get what you wish for with a year in quarantine. Until next time, friends, this is The Mary Moran Show.